Okay.
All right, you have to, I'll do the interview, introduction. My name is Kimberly Cucci, and I am interviewing Harriett Chittenden Pierson Berman, which we've decided is quite a mouthful. And today's date is April 1st, 1995, and Harriett's been gracious enough to allow me in her White Lake cottage so that we can talk about how the first thing would be how her family first came up here to White Lake, found it, and then started visiting it as regular summer people. So I'm going to turn the floor over to Harriett and let her start with telling us how her family first found White Lake.
Thank you. Daddy came up from St. Louis, where we were living, on a United States Navy training ship with his best friend. It was a real outing for them. They moored the boat, the training ship, out just opposite the tennis courts and were rowed ashore and walked to the Michigan side and fell in love with it. Cottages had been built there. Pretty much the same. Nothing changes up here. Maybe the insides do, but never the outsides. The insides only because people want to live here all year round and put in a furnace and put paneling on the insides to cover the studs. Some of them leave the studs and cover them with pictures. But Daddy did not come back to this area for something like 5 years. We lived across the street in St. Louis from the Middletons, who had a cottage up here. And they persuaded us to come.
And this is Peg Dilley's grandparents?
Her grandparents.
Grandparents, wow.
And, oh, I got to tell you something. Because Mr. Middleton used to sing with Daddy in the choir in St. Louis at the Ascension Church. But Mrs. Middleton was deaf, and she heard through a horn that she put in her ear, and it came out like this and curved up, and you would talk into that thing. And then she would hand the horn to somebody else. And they would talk into it.
I've only seen that in the movies.
It was priceless, and there are no pictures of her, I don't believe. Well, Daddy and Mother put the three kids and a maid and a cook onto the Wabash Railroad in St. Louis and sent us to Chicago. And we got to White Lake by way of the Parmalee bus in Chicago, which was pulled by a team of horses, and they piled on it the trunks because you came for the whole season and it was cold and you didn't leave until Labor Day and maybe it snowed by then. And all the fleeces, all the paraphernalia climbed onto the one wagon, the bus, the seats along the sides. And they would take us to the Navy Pier, which was a pier at that time. And the Goodrich boats were moored there. And there were three or four boats in that fleet that would go to South Haven, Grand Haven, Muskegon, White Lake, and up to the Sioux. Well, we never went there. We got as far as White Lake. And my brother and I slept in one stateroom, in one berth. My sister slept on the top deck. Dad and Mother had a whole stateroom adjoining. But Loker and I would get up in the morning and go out on deck and hang over the sides, straining our eyes to see the shoreline. And when it finally came into view, we were ecstatic. We would run from the bow of the boat to the stern, back and forth and back and forth, and knocking on doors, getting everybody in the boat up so that they could see the channel.
Land ho.
When we came through, it was a thrill, and silence absolutely swept that boat when we got into White Lake, and they would head toward the Silver Beach dock. Usually, people who were already here would come down to meet the boat. You not only came to meet it, but you came at night to send it back. So it was a social event. We rented cottages for years, but we could only rent them, at least Daddy said we could only rent them every other year, because he couldn't afford to pay rent every year. He had to earn the money to save it to pay for the rent the next year. We started at one end, the south end, and finally moved up cottage by cottage until we got to the what is now Nancy, what's her last name?
Books.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it used to be the Cole Cottage and the Dvorak. We loved to say that. It was a tongue tither. And the partitions on the second floor where the bedrooms were went only halfway. But this was true in many of the cottages. They saved the lumber. Mm-hmm. Well, Loker and I spent the nights having a pillow fight with sailing the pillows across the divide. And it was a riot and a lot of fun.
Now, this is your older brother? Or
My youngest brother, my only brother. Okay. They were 16 months apart. Mm. So we were inseparable all of our lives. Mother finally got fed up on running a house in St. Louis and running a house at the beach. So she read the riot act to Daddy, and he says, okay, go to the hotel, meaning the Sylvan Beach Hotel. So Mother waltzed herself down and rented rooms 1, 2, and 3, which were adjoining rooms on the second floor at the top of the staircase. There was the room that had the door into the hall was Mother's room. And Loker and I shared a room, which was on the corner. And then my sister, Christine, had the room behind it because she was the oldest and had earned the right to a room by herself. She must have been close to 13 at that time, and quite a lady and a pill, because she had been raised in the Sacred Heart Convent, and when she went to a beach party, she wore white gloves. Oh. Believe that one or not. And when we played kissing games at the beach party, she would put out her hand
sweet. Charming.
We all hooted.
Wow.
Couldn't stand it. Well, I'm getting off the beaten track here, because I do want to tell you what was taking place while we were in the cottages. Because once Mother made the break with having housemaids and cooks and things, we didn't have any help. And this was just about 1912, I guess. Anyway, it was during the war, World War I, and the yacht club had already been built, had a sailing crew, sailboats, all the launches parked there, and the yachts. But the yacht club had to close because all the boys were in service.
Yeah.
And I had forgotten how long that remained dark. But it finally opened up when the boys started coming home. And since Stuart had three friends of his from Flint who played instruments, and he housed them in his boathouse down next to the post office on White Lake. And they would go over and play at the Yacht Club on Saturday nights, though they played at the Wabanango Club for the dances on Wednesday nights. And all the kids, well chaperoned by their parents, would go down and dance from 8:30 until 9:30, and then it was time to go home.
And was this the where the dances were? Is it like it was today, sort of, where all the girls are on one side of the room and all the boys are
on the other? Yes, indeed it was. And my generation was just learning how to dance, so it meant you walked one side of the Wild Club and two-step at the corner, and walked to the next corner where you two-stepped, and that's how you made it around the room. You danced to a piano. There wasn't an orchestra most of the time, but when we did, it was usually Sid Stewart's. A bunch from Illinois came up. Orm Lyman was one. Orm Lyman still comes to see Peg Van once a year. I have been doing something else and I haven't seen him. But he was the piano player, and boy could he play. They had a saxophone, and it was four pieces, and they lived in the boathouse. Finally, they moved to the Yacht Club, which had a balcony over the ballroom, and they climbed a ladder to get up there, and that's where they slept.
I think I still see the outside opening of that on the Yacht Club building, which is boarded up actually now, but somebody pointed that out to me. That area is the attic where these kids used to stay.
That's right.
So that's kind of cool.
So anyway, the Yacht Club finally came into being after the war. I'm going to go from the Yacht Club down as far as the pier, because that was the first thing we saw when we came in to White Lake from the, it was the Carolina that we came on. The fleet into White Lake was the Carolina, the Georgia, and the Alabama. The Alabama happened to be the flagship. Once the Columbus came in, and that was a whaleback, the Georgia was top-heavy, obviously, so she leaned way over. But the...
Sounds like kind of a scary boat to be traveling on.
It was, and it had a bridge that came from the bow to the stern.
Wow.
Like this. Nobody ever went on the bridge.
Yeah.
But it was smaller than the...
Carolina.
But on the Carolina, I've got to put this one in because I've got some of the junk off of the boat. The Carolina was auctioned off, I'll say recently, within the last 40 years. For me, that's recent. And I saw an ad in the White Lake Forum that the Carolina was up for auction down in St. Joe. So I get in my sedan, a Chevy sedan, with a hammer and a screwdriver. At least I knew what to take with me. I got down there. I was the only person on board. The auction was to be the following day, but people had been there and had taken off some of the stuff.
Already.
All I wanted was a hanging on the wall above the wash basin which was portable, was a mirror and a little shelf. I've got it there.
Well, we'll have to take a picture of it.
We'll have to take it of it later.
Yeah.
I wanted that it had a place for the water pitcher and two glasses and a towel bar at the bottom. Mm-hmm. And I wanted that. And then I wanted a sign that was on the wall next to the door to the stateroom. One ring bellboy, two rings ice water. And I wanted one of those. They had been stripped off of the walls, and I did not get one. But I did get other things. Mm-hmm. I got the signs in there. Well, they're still on the porch. And here, a fire axe and a sign which says, when this bell rings, go on deck immediately. I got one of those. I got a handful of stateroom keys. And I guess that's about all. But if I had not had my hammer and my screwdriver, yeah, I would have had nothing. And he charged me $2.50 for those treasures.
Like you were reading the paper to find was an auction.
What was there? Now you don't have a...
No, mine isn't working, but I can stop at any time.
To get back to when we first came into White Lake, the first thing we would see was the channel. At that time, the catwalk was built high, which was a walkway from the shore to the end of the south pier where there was the light.
And it was just a single file?
Single file, and the lighthouse gentleman who ran the lighthouse every night would walk with the light on the catwalk down and place the light on the end of the pier and then walk back again. And when they took down that catwalk, it was wrenched every heart of every resorter and also the lifesavers. Now the pier itself was used for fishing, but not to the extent, of course, that it is now because of transportation. But on the north pier was the life-saving station, and it was called life-saving at that time, early, where the lifesavers and their families lived. And the lifesavers would have drills in the channel at 8 o'clock every morning, and all the kids from Sylvan would run down to the lighthouse across the channel and watch the lifesavers turn over the boat and right it and get in and row out to the big lake. Their families, while living there, had to have something to do, so their wives decided that they would make mini blouses and skirts for the resorters. And so you would go walk down to the lighthouse and wave, and a lifesaver would come over in the rowboat, and we would all go over and be measured for what we were going to wear for the summer, because that was the thing to wear.
And I'm not familiar with that design. Is it just a white blouse?
A white midi blouse with a sailor collar, which was blue with white tape on it, embroidered stars in each of the corners. The boys had little pants that buckled at the knee, below the knee, and the girls had skirts. And when the lifesaver had wife had finished the thing, she would send word by somebody who was going to come over to the beach that the things were filled, or were finished, and we'd row over again and get them and bring them home.
Now, were they made of cotton or wool? Or?
Oh, no, they were made of linen.
Oh, my land.
They were made of linen, and they were perfectly beautiful.
They sound gorgeous.
Well, they were gorgeous.
Yeah.
And they were pretty much like the navy blouses mm-hmm. that the enlisted men mm-hmm. wear.
So this was high fashion.
This was high fashion, yes. Mm-hmm. Well, they had these drills every morning, but when it was so rough that they couldn't go out into Lake Michigan to put on a demonstration, on the south of the South Pier, there was a boathouse, and in it was one of the big rescue boats. And they would push that thing over the sand out into the water, being sheltered by the north, by the South Pier, and get out to make any sort of a rescue that they would have to do. Also south of that pier was the pump house for the Sylvan Beach Resort. There was no water supply here, so they ran a pipe from like the Dupree's cottage mm-hmm. down the bank across the sand dunes to this little pump house, and then the pipe went on from the pump house on the bottom of Lake Michigan till they hit deep water. They would turn the pump on in the little pump house, and it would suck the water in, and it would settle into a settling tank, which was just an open hole in this house, and the sand would fall to the bottom, and the clear water would be pumped up the hill, up the staircase, to the water tank behind. That was the sole water supply for the entire association. It was piped from the water tower with big pipes, say 3-inch pipes, I think, above ground. And then each cottage would tap into that pipe, main pipe. Sometimes you had water, and sometimes somebody had taken all the water, and you just didn't have any.
Mm. I think I've seen part of that pump house. I had never knew that it had existed, and then one summer we came up here, and through the winter it had been uncovered through storms, and half of it partially. And I think I haven't been down this year, but at least it's been showing partially now some couple of years now.
Well, they just left it. They filled.
Right.
They filled the pool,
mm-hmm.
the settling pool.
Right.
So, but it was. You could hear the pump going, and the caretaker from the beach would go down and start that pump before anybody was awake, so that they would have water in their cottages. Otherwise, it was a pitcher mm-hmm. of water that you kept filled all the time, and a wash basin.
Yeah.
There was no plumbing at that time. You had an outhouse, 3-holer, Papa, Mama, and little kids.
And Baby Bear.
and Baby Bear. And then each fall, that house, we call it the chick sales, would be moved and the hole filled.
Mm.
And this is how the plumbing went on. Under each bed, there was a pot. Sometime a tall pot, sometime one that you'd squat on and never get up. But they were things of beauty.
Mm-hmm.
I'll tell you that. And we had, in all the cottages, you had a wash basin. But the hotel had 2 bathrooms at the end of the hall with a tub, one tub, which was in a separate little room. Two Johns, each with a door, connecting by a knot hole that the kids would peek through, and two wash basins. And that was the plumbing for the entire hotel.
But so still, that'd be pretty luxurious, it sounds like.
It was. It was. I always used the wash basin because Mother took so long because she took a bath. And all these women would go down in their kimonos, a lot of them with feathers trimmed because they wanted to impress the single men that had come for vacations and weekends.
Can you describe a little bit more about the Sylvan Beach Hotel? I know we were talking about the fact that it had fire escapes.
Oh, the fire escapes were nailed. They were wood to begin with.
Right.
On either side of what side of the building. Mm-hmm. It was a long, narrow building. Across the front, there was the office and a little room where they had the slot machines. And across the other side was a hall and the living room, which was had a piano in it and wicker furniture. Mm-hmm. Then a staircase that was divided that went from both sides of the hall up to the second floor. And it had one main hall that went down to the Johns. Mm-hmm. And a little back porch. And it was on the little back porch where you hung your bathing suit. Mm-hmm. To dry. And many a time a corset, because those women were so proud, they would get in a corset and put their suit over it. Mm. And of course they were the had the sleeves and a sailor collar on them and a skirt. Mm-hmm. That buttoned on. And you wore that until you were in your teens. Mm.
Hard to imagine going swimming
dressed
so much.
Ruth Pillinger was a gorgeous looking blonde, tall, beautiful legs. The men just went wild when she'd come down. She always wore black stockings. Mm. Full length all the way up. Too bad they didn't have pantyhose then.
Yeah.
Because it would have been the thing and the answer. But it wasn't. And she had a satin neckerchief around her hair with her bathing cap underneath it, but tied in a foreign hand at the end, standing out like that. She was a picture to behold. Also, Eleanor Meyer, who came up from St. Louis. Her father owned the Meyer drug company, and she was the most popular girl up here. Just gorgeous. And she knew how to get the boys. Talk about vamping. She knew all the answers to it. She was only a year older than I, and I was still climbing trees and stuff. But, oh, I want to tell you, while I'm still on the lighthouse people, they had a man, one of the crew, who walked from the pier to Duck Lake every night with a lantern. Hmm. And back. And many a time when we were at a beach party, we would join up because what he was looking for were drowned bodies.
Oh, my lands. From what? I mean, just
wrecks, people falling off of boats. And drowning.
Did they find many?
They did find many. One night we were all at a beach party down there and a body rolled up.
Oh my lands, I've never heard of this.
Right by the fire, and all the mothers herded those kids up the stairs to go home as fast as possible so they wouldn't see them. But it was a real job, that patrolling Lake Michigan Beach.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's quite a walk, really, for every night.
For every night.
And then back, sure.
That's right. I don't even remember how many times a night they did this, mm-hmm. but this was part of their work. Even when the lifesavers became the Coast Guard, mm-hmm. as they are now, or used to be, and occupying the same building and all, mm-hmm. that Coast Guard building is now over facing onto the old channel. Mm-hmm. And it is a residence, mm-hmm. and they've done a beautiful job with it.
Oh, I didn't know that they had actually moved that building. I thought that they had just destroyed it.
Oh, no, you don't destroy much.
Yeah, that's good.
Because you might need it.
That's right.
Our fire protection was a thing that took over almost every annual meeting because it was lack of. Mm-hmm. Every cottage is required, even now, to have 2 50-foot hoses, one at the front and one at the back, in case of an emergency. Mm-hmm. But these garden hoses were our protection. Fire extinguishers were unheard of, because you had to get them out of Muskegon, and they mm-hmm. didn't come to sell them. Right. The hotel had one in the office downstairs and one at the top of the stairs. The people who came to the hotel reserved their rooms year after year after year after year. What's her name?
Who are you trying to think of?
Jane Pelton's mm. family came up from St. Louis. And she played the piano, and we would all sing after supper time at night if we weren't going to a beach party or going to one of the dances. And it was great fun. The ladies would play bridge or any of the current games, and they also had card parties at the WOM Club on Wednesday afternoons. The mothers would gussy up in their shirt waists and skirts and a sash and go down to the WOM Club to play cards. I don't know what was the popular card at the time, but they never missed.
Now at that time, the WOM Club was really a separate entity, was it not? It wasn't really part of the association. It had its own members, and is that true, or the Wabaningo Club?
Yeah, no, you had to take out a membership for the WOM Club, and some took it out and some didn't.
And so they just came as guests? And
came as guests, or they would stand out on the porch and watch. Mm-hmm. But that's as far as it really went. About the fire protection, at one time we had a fire engine, one wagon that had two ladders on it, on the sides, and a long handle and four wheels. It was housed in a little shed behind Joe Hartman's cottage. It did sport a great big brass bell, and that would be rung when you had a fire drill. Now, remember, there were only women here. Mm-hmm. The men came for the weekends, mm-hmm. so the women had to be able to pull this wagon out and go to the fire and pump it to get water from the water tank to the fire. There was never a fire, and it's just as well they never could have done it. But we all went to the fire drills. Mm-hmm. and stood around on the outside while these women were trying to move the wagon out.
And did you practice this like once a month or?
I have forgotten once that summer? Because we were kids and yeah. It was the mothers
right.
who were doing this.
Yeah.
And the servants.
Mm-hmm.
Because all the cottages had a maid's room.
Mm-hmm.
And it could be in a wash house in the backyard, or it could be part of the cottage itself.
Mm-hmm.
But there was always a screen porch on the back end of each cottage, a summer kitchen. That's where you had your sink, your stove, which was a wood stove, maybe a coal oil, two-burner stove, a ice box.
Mm-hmm.
And the ice was cut by the caretaker in the winter out of White Lake and cut into cubes and put in the ice house. To me, it's still the ice house, mm-hmm. though Kelly Sellers bought that thing and has used it ever since.
Mm-hmm.
But that's where the ice was cut and with layers of sawdust in between to keep the melt from it. Then it was put on the ice wagon and pulled by horses from cottage to cottage to cottage. And you would go out and tell them how much ice you had. There wasn't an ice box that had more than 50-pound capacity. So you would go out and he'd bring his ice tongs in. Some of us kept the ice tongs.
Mm-hmm.
I have some in my garage hanging on the wall.
How long would a block of ice last?
You couldn't drink them.
Right.
You couldn't put it in water to get the water cold. You would put a pitcher in a bowl of ice
mm-hmm.
to get cold
sure.
water.
But I mean, how often did you have to get a new block of ice for your ice box?
I have no idea, but it came at least every other day.
Okay, yeah. I know, I mean,
it had just, to.
Yeah. I was wondering about that being July and August and
sure,
along with that.
Because you came for the season.
Right.
With your trunks and all your paraphernalia, your winter clothes mm-hmm. to put on at Labor Day, because you didn't go back until the day after
right.
Labor Day.
It
was wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
I want to tell you about a family here, the Spickelmeyer family.
Mm-hmm.
Rose was the postmistress. She was a voluptuous woman with a fiery temper and one for law and order. She would open that post office at her timing, and the door was locked to keep you out until all the mail was sorted. Then she would raise the window, and you would ask for your mail, unless you were one of the lucky ones that had a lockbox.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they're still down here mm-hmm. at our own post office. But Rose would stop you at the slightest provocation to tell you about Chester. Chester was in the radio during the war. He was in the Navy, but he was a radio receiver. And when Chester came home, it was the biggest day of anyone's life. Her husband was Charlie. Charlie was bent over, and Charlie carried lumber from their cottage to wherever he was building. He could not drive because they had arrested him for drunken driving. Heavens knows what he was driving, because there were only the two cars on the beach, but he must have had some sort of a conveyance. So he carried the lumber one plank at a time up the White Lake stairs, along the top of the bank, followed by his little fox terrier. who was the most devoted dog I've ever known in her life. Now, Chester was also a carpenter, but he was also owned the Three Sisters Launch. Mm. And he was the pilot on that. He hefted in the trunks, all the vegetables that you bought uptown and brought back here, though the vegetable wagon would stop twice a week and come to your back door and you'd go out.
Now, I'm a little confused. Charlie is Rose's husband?
Was Rose's husband.
And Chester is their son. Okay.
Their son.
There you go. I just wanted to make sure I had that right.
That's right. Chester was very good looking, mm-hmm. and much sought after by some of the single ladies that would come up. And there were two beauts that came to the hotel in their negligees trimmed in marabou feathers, and they would stand out in the hall at every thunderclap. And there were no electrical lights, there were acetylene lights. Mm-hmm. So they cast beautiful shadows on the wall. Everybody stood out in the hall because you were scared to death you were going to get hit by lightning.
I know, sometimes I feel that way now.
Well, our fires that we had up here at the beach were started awesome. Mainly from lightning. Mm-hmm. But I want to tell you about Charlie and his wonderful ceilings. You go into some of the old cottages now, you look up. Mm-hmm. They are a work of art.
That's
right.
He was the carpenter for that. And that's, our ceilings do have all these wonderful cross beams running back and forth.
Back and forth.
Makes a beautiful
and
beautiful pattern.
My front porch mm-hmm. is
slopes. I'll have to take a video of that.
But it was, he was a master craftsman. Mm-hmm.
Now, was he responsible for building a lot of the
a
White
of
Lake
the
side? Or did he also make a lot of the Lake Michigan side?
Because they lived here.
Okay.
Down, and the cottage is still there. Mm-hmm. Spickelmeyer's is, of course, rented now. But they kept it like it was with the columns supporting the second floor. Mm. That's still in that cottage.
Whose cottage is that now? I'm really terrible at that stuff now.
I don't know. Irene would know because she knows everybody down there. Mm-hmm. But it was considered the last cottage on the beach. And Garin's really was the last cottage on the beach. Mm-hmm. Now, Garin's cottage was on the sand hill up from Dave Rice's first cottage that he had. Mm. It was a Pillinger cottage.
Oh yeah, okay.
At one time, the Pillinger family owned 7 cottages
right.
at the beach.
Yeah, I've heard that.
All occupied. Mm-hmm. And it was something.
I bet. Big family clan like that.
Of all sorts descriptions. Mm-hmm. And the Garin cottage was built on the sandhill above all those cottages. Ross's cottage, that's Betsy Davis' cottage, mm-hmm. was one of the first ones down there. And she was Betsy Ross, and she was on the stage, a ballet dancer. Mm. Didn't you know that?
No, I didn't.
Oh, yes, and her mother had the whole cottage decorated in full-blown roses mm. everywhere. In fact, as we decorated the Wob Club only in roses one year, where the roof goes up and all the timbers, mm-hmm. we nailed roses on that.
Paper roses?
Artificial roses. Mm-hmm. Not paper,
okay.
Really artificial roses, hmm. gorgeous things. I don't know who had them. But Betsy's mother was also on the stage, also Mrs. Crandall. Mm-hmm. They lived next door to this cottage here, it burned during the big fire. Mm-hmm. When 8 cottages went in November, and it was caused by a short in the Kidston cottage, which was the last cottage. Remodeling, and a spark started, and there was a wind, and it came right straight down. The fire department did its best. The hose would not reach the lake, so they could not pump any water. It was out of season, so of course there was no water to be had. The cottages went in one terrific blaze. Nothing being left but the cast iron bathtubs in these cottages. And there are pictures, and you'll get to see them. It came down as far as our side lot, which remains a lot, where we had gorgeous trees that Mother simply kept and loved. They burned every tree and scorched the north side of the cottage, and the wind changed. And that's the only thing. Otherwise, everything on the white light side would have gone.
Yeah.
Just as now, if a cottage catches on fire, do not save that cottage, but the one next to it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I think that that should be reviewed annually.
Mm-hmm. I know, I've seen those pictures, and it's enough to break your heart. I
mean, it is.
It looks, it's just so devastating. So that was very fortunate for your family, almost.
That's right. At the end of the channel, I'm hitting and missing, but the whole picture is going to be before you, before long.
Mm-hmm.
At the end, east end of the channel, there were fishing tugs and fishermen's houses. Their families lived there. And the head fisherman was a man by the name of Grover, Mr. Grover. And they put fishing nets out in Lake Michigan, north and south of the piers. And they would go out every morning at dawn and empty those nets into their boats, and they would bring them in, gutting the fish and scaling them on the way in. They anchored their boats in front of that big sand hill, which still stands over there.
Where
at the
that,
end
in that
of the
cove?
In that cove.
Mm-hmm.
And if you wanted a fresh fish, you went down to the channel and called across what kind of a fish you wanted. They would send it over via rowboat, and you had fresh fish.
My husband would just love that.
And the nets were taken off, washed, and put on reels and spun around to dry. The nets were dry before they were ever put on the boat to go out the next morning. It's too bad that some of that hasn't been preserved.
Mm-hmm.
But it's all gone. I do have a picture of the fishing tugs and some of the reels.
Ooh.
And I'll get it out sometime.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe for the art museum that we have down there.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to stop here a minute.
Good.
I can get that stuff.
Oops. All right.
I want to say something about the Goodrich boats that came in. The Carolina was a favorite. That was had also been a hospital ship at one time. The Georgia belonged to the same fleet, and the Alabama was the flagship of the Goodrich Line, based in Chicago. The Columbia was a whaleback, and it only came in once, but everybody turned out to see it. Now, the first place that the Goodrich liner stopped coming into White Lake was Sylvan Beach. And it would come in, and the Stufflebe was his name, the captain. We always call him Stufflebottom. And Bob Lanier remembers this well. And he would bring that Carolina in and hit the piling, and the piling would go clear over to one side, and you'd think sure that he was going to hit the dock. He never did. But he unloaded trunks and things for Murray's and for Sylvan Beach Hotel, as also the individual cottagers. Down on the dock, there was a square building that was a trunk room. And that is the what is now the post office.
Mm.
It became the Valhalla shop. Now, I haven't told you about the Valhalla shop.
No.
Mm-mm. That was a little square building. I better get back to the boats first.
Okay, and then we'll return to the gift shop.
Anyway, in order to get the trunks and the suitcases and things down to Murray's, because he only had that one tin Lizzie, and the weight of the trunks would have sunken in the sand. So he would struggle getting these trunks, and they were all packing trunks, great big enormous things. Well, of course, there were no laundries around here, everything, and you had to have clean clothes. You couldn't wash and iron. There was no means of doing that. So you carried everything with you from home. He would pile these trunks and suitcases and things into the rowboat and row it down to Murray's Inn, where he did get help in unloading them and getting them up into the rooms that the tenants had reserved. But it was Pat, with his shock of red hair, that you looked for every time one of the Goodrich boats landed, because he was the guy that did the rowing of all of that, what do you call it? Valises and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Just everyone's trunks, suitcases.
Yeah,
and
everything.
For the summer.
Well, then the boat would back up and go to Lakeside, which was Michelinda.
Mm-hmm.
And that dock stood so high up that they had to build a ramp for the people to get on and off that dock to get onto the boat, because that was where another sinkhole went.
Hmm.
So that will come as a surprise to some of you, because it has just been uncovered within the last year. Somebody went through the old newspapers and found a copy of the Forum that had the story of this sinkhole.
Well, can you tell me about that, Harriett? Because I have not heard about that, so.
Well, will you turn it off right now and
No, you tell me while it's taping.
Well, I want to refresh my memory.
Sure.
That's what I want to do, because it's only a short thing like this, paragraph.
All right.
Yeah, they ought to know about that.
Oh, yeah, I haven't heard about that one. Okay.
I have in my hand a paragraph from the Whitehall Forum, dated 1894, July the 19th. Since none of us oldsters knew anything about this, because we weren't here, this has just recently come to the top of the pile of curiosity by people doing genealogy and things. I'll read it to you. And Dottie Hinema insists that where this sand hill disappeared is right under her house because there is a dip. Hmm. All right, July the 19th, 1894. One of the most curious phenomena of the East Lake Shore has been noticed at the foot of White Lake, where last year a towering sandhill occupied the region between the old green mill and the woods of Sylvan Beach. Of a sudden, this hill began to sink away, and in the space of a few hours was entirely lost to sight. And now a great pool of water marks the spot where it formerly reared itself to its great height. What became of the immense mountain of sand is a mystery. The water in White Lake near that point is deeper than at any other place on the lake, sounding about 40 feet. It is thought that the weight of the hill causes submarine banks to give way, and the big sand dome sank into the waters, much as the big sinkholes sometimes form on railroad tracks. The suddenness of the hill's departure is certainly a most wonderful affair. I'll leave it to all of you to think about.
That's wonderful. I have seen pictures of that hill and have just thought through all this time it was eroded away. This is the first time I've ever heard about this explanation, and that, so this is a real find.
It really mm-hmm. is.
Yeah, if I was over there, I'd be concerned. If I had,
I would too.
Yeah, because you know, if your land is
It's all undermined.
Yeah,
and with the water rising and lowering, mm-hmm. it's bound to float.
Sure.
Really.
Sure.
Instead of being firm and all mm-hmm. the way down.
Yeah.
I'll
tell you. And that was a year before the association came into being.
Right.
So
right.
101 years ago.
So you see?
That's great.
We got a bit of history here.
Yeah.
Now I have to find out where it was. Stop it.
Mm-hmm. You had been talking about Carolina being the most favorite of the boats, and Pat from Myers rowing the Felices down to Murray's Inn, and then its next step or stop being. Mm-hmm. And that was kind of a point of confusion for me for a while, the lakeside being called Michelinda. Because, of course, when I think of Michelinda, I think of the resort so that took me a little while to kind of catch on to that, area, right, had been defined as Michelinda there. So now that when you say that, now I understand that that's really around by Lakeside, where the inn is.
Yeah.
And where there must have been an old sawmill?
Yeah, green.
Okay.
The green mill.
Right. And that's about where you left off.
Okay.
So then it would just kind of continue its way up the lake, I take it?
You mean the sinkhole?
No, the steamship liners.
The Carolina, the boats.
Right.
The Goodrich boats.
Right.
Would overnight at Whitehall or at Montague, mm-hmm. and then come down and pick up the passengers in reverse order.
Mm-hmm.
The next morning, or the night, evening of the same day that they had come from Chicago.
And did those people also hoist those little flags by the docks to let the...
No, but that was regular scheduled stops.
Oh, okay, so they just, they came in
the others stop. Were anytime. They had a, all had a schedule.
Right.
When the boats would be going by, and they'd hoist the flag.
Hard to imagine a boat that size in White Lake. I mean, seeing the pictures and all of them.
Yeah.
It's just...
They were big.
Huge. They were really big.
They were big. On the Carolina were real treasures. And even at a young age, I recognized several things in the staterooms that someday I wanted to own. And finally, the Carolina went up for auction in St. Joe. And I thought, this is my chance. So I got a hammer and a screwdriver and got in my Chevrolet sedan and drove to St. Joe. I was the only person on that boat other than the crew. The auction was the next day, but people had been in before and had stripped it of many of the things, which just broke my heart, because one of the things I wanted in particularly was a sign that was nailed on the inside of every stateroom door. One, ring bellboy. Two, rings ice water. And we would no sooner get into that stateroom than my brother would ring that bell twice. We were lousy with water pitchers of ice water. Anyway, the sign had been destroyed. There was not one on that boat. We went from stateroom to stateroom. But I did come away with a fire axe and a sign that says, "When you hear this bell, go on deck immediately." I got the fire axe, and it's red, and I have it hanging in my downstairs hall. I got a handful of room keys, all exactly alike, though none of us ever knew it at the time. There were menus. And I think that's all I was able to get. But during this last summer, I was asked to give a program along with Edna Bloomdahl and Ruth Pitkin and Jack Mason, who lives over facing the golf course on South Shore Road. He was one of the first settlers up here. His family were. And he gave a wonderful talk about the Goodrich Line. And that is being preserved in Whitehall. So if you get your curiosity up, you can listen to that sometime. Click it off.
Okay.
You wanted to tell me a story about your mom and the fire?
And fire protection.
Mm-hmm.
Mother was just gung-ho because of the lack of fire protection for the association. Every annual meeting, Mother got up and ranted and raved about the fire protection and the fact that the board had never taken action on it. So, anyway, she thought she would get some notoriety. So, click it. Where is that? Because that's a good story. Oh, at one of the annual meetings, she said, "I'll give you $200 to start a fund for fire protection." And Mr. Rooney, who owns Arthur Holt's cottage, was president, and he walked by Mother's house in the following week, and he said, "Nan, did you get any more donations from the people on the beach for fire protection?" And she said, "No." Well, he said, "You should have told them the story that you told me, that you would give $200 to start the ball rolling. But when they refused, she bought a tablecloth." And so she goes uptown to tell Louis Berman, who was editor of the Forum, this story. And he said, "Well, Nan, how many people did you get to stop by and give you some money for the fire protections?" She said, "I didn't get anyone, but you should have seen the crowd that came to see that tablecloth." And I got the tablecloth.
Oh, that's a cute story.
Yeah.
That's great.
But it's things like that that make you laugh about your living.
Mm-hmm.
And just staying alive.
Mm-hmm.
But people used to come from Chicago, and they were foreigners, and from mainly the Latin countries. And one pair of men came over from Chicago while we were staying at the hotel and brought in suitcases bulging with the handsomest table linen you've ever seen in your life. They had come from the Belgian Lace Company on Michigan Avenue in Chicago.
Mm.
They would display all these tablecloths, napkins, cocktail napkins, towels, sheets, pillowcases, magnificent handmade things. They would take orders. They'd be back the next week with what you had ordered and collected COT.
Wow.
It was wonderful.
Very nice. Better than catalog shopping like we've got today.
That is absolutely right.
Sounds like beautiful things too.
And that was when we finally, had somebody else that came around from across the channel back in the woods from Indian Bay. Mm-hmm. And that was, there was a group of Indians still living there. And the Indian woman, we called her, would come over several times during the summer. She would row across from Indian Bay, the old channel, mm-hmm. to Murray's Inn, and pull her boat up and then carry this enormous brown cloth bag that she was a square, and she had everything piled in it. And she put it over her shoulder, and she stopped from cottage to cottage. And she would spread this display of baskets and scissor holders, thimble cases, pin cushions.
And she made all these? Or
these
she...
were made mm-hmm. by that
group, or...
group of Indians over there of sweetgrass. Mm. I have some examples here that you will get to see. If you put your face real low, you could still smell some of the sweetgrass.
Now, is sweetgrass, is that something that's around here? Is that the dune grass? That what I would call dune grass?
No, it's a very fine grass.
Okay.
As you can see mm-hmm. over there by the...
Yeah, I just
you
love
see?
The muted colors.
Of course, this was very gay at one mm-hmm. time.
Oh, I know. Look at the
you
inside.
You see the inside. And beautifully done.
Mm-hmm.
And those of us that had them and used them, I use it as my sewing basket.
Mm-hmm.
That was for a thimble.
That's precious. I'll have to get a better shot of that.
Because it has a little beer bird on the top of it. And the pin cushion. But she would come, and everybody had sweetgrass things in their homes.
About how old were you?
I must have been 11.
Mm-hmm.
Because I was interested in it.
Okay.
And she was a tremendous woman. Mm-hmm. I mean, voluptuous and big hips and a rag around her head.
Mm-hmm.
But that family still lives in this area.
Mm.
The kids go to Whitehall schools. You can tell that they're Indian.
Can you recall their last name? Or
I'm trying to, Edna knows it.
Yeah.
I keep forgetting.
And I think someone's, I don't know if it's Armstrong or, I know that there are a family that's still here that has Indian origins because.
This begins with an S.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Shalafo or something like that.
Okay. Yeah, I'll have to ask Edna then.
But there's quite an Indian grouping in this area,
mm-hmm.
clear into Muskegon.
So that seemed probably pretty exotic at 11 years old.
But it was.
Mm-hmm.
It was. I'd never seen an Indian before.
Mm-hmm.
But they used to camp down at Murray's.
Mm-hmm.
They had a camp down there.
Flick it.
Most loved of all the people that have lived at the beach, lived on the area above where the last cottage is, Betsy Ross's and then this somebody else's.
Okay.
Diamonds, up on the hill from Diamonds.
All right.
And behind that cottage, which was called the Valhalla, because they thought that it was the home of the gods. And you get kind of cold shivers when you think of it.
Mm-hmm.
And that cottage was the anchor place of all the teenagers, and maybe those pre-teenagers. Because she had a little square building out at the rear of the cottage that she took over and named the Valhalla Shop. And she imported things from New York and from Chicago, anything that was local. We had the first cast flamingos, and in some of the cottage there are still three flamingos flying with their wings at different heights. Everybody had them above a door. Must have cost a dollar and a half for the three of them. We all had them. I bought a Lalique vase, lavender, from her for Mother's Day present for my mother, and it cost $11.
Oh, my land.
It's about 14 inches tall.
Oh.
It's still in prime shape, and I use it for lilacs every spring.
Oh, that's wonderful.
It's just...
Especially lilacs.
Lilacs. Well, their place was hit, the cottage was hit by lightning and it burned to the ground.
Mm-hmm.
The little shop also went. So she took over the trunk room down at the dock. Next to the shipman's boathouse. Some of you have long forgotten the shipman group, but Junior Shipman, the son, used to walk the tight wire at the jigs, and he sang Michigan song all the way across that wire. He did it year after year after year. Well, surprisingly, his daughter was at my back door this summer looking for someone who would remember the Shipman family.
Oh, how wonderful that they found you.
They found me, and I was just full
yeah.
of things to tell, because I used to go to a dance, or at least Junior, as his name was, mm-hmm. would ask me to dance at the WOB Club, because most of the people at the beach did not belong to the yacht club, mm-hmm. because you had to pay dues. Mm-hmm. So that left being a guest if you got to go. Once in a while, Sam Post would ask me to go.
Oh, really?
Oh, yes, and he was one that walked the border of the room, two-stepped at the corner, and then went on to the other straight pieces. His sister, Margaret Post, had an old town canoe. It is now in my boathouse. Dwayne wants to give it away. He says, give it to the museum. It's an heirloom. And I said, not on your life. But it was the tippiest thing you can imagine. If you sneezed, you went over. But Margaret was the girl who every year swam from the beach dock to the Whitehall dock. Breaststroke.
I've heard of that. When I interviewed Betty Bennett, Sam's daughter.
Yeah.
And I was looking through her father's photo album, I saw this very athletic looking woman. And she was diving and swimming, and Betty was telling me that every year she used to swim the length of the lake, and that was a big thing, you know.
That
and
was, it was.
It is a big thing. I can't imagine doing that.
Well, kids
especially
nowadays,
back that time, you know, that's kind of actually.
That's right, and it was breaststroke.
Yeah. I mean, so.
But.
Now, did you guys follow along when she went? I mean, did
no,
you?
No, somebody in a putt-putt
okay.
did.
Yeah.
Quite a ways from her.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I can remember our kids and the Stewart kids and the Kasperi kids. That's where Barb Wagner lives.
Mm-hmm.
Kasperi Cottage. La Maisonette.
Yes.
She was French. She was French. Our kids were made to swim across the channel with a rowboat beside them before they could ever go out alone in a boat. And we held to that.
That's smart thinking.
And then the next year, after they had earned the right to be in a boat, they decided to swim from Sylvan Beach Dock to the yacht club. Mm-hmm. And we patrolled them. Let me tell you, we were scared to death for those kids. They couldn't have been 12 years old.
Mm.
And they remember it distinctly.
No doubt.
It was a challenge, but people swam in those days.
Mm-hmm.
You set your own stakes and
mm-hmm. From
you
here
made
to
it.
There, and
that's right. So that was a lot of fun. Nobody does it anymore. But we used to have drownings, many drownings, every year in White Lake. One day there were 6 drownings.
Now see, I never hear those stories. I mean, so, but they weren't really then from people that were here at the beach.
No, they were from around the lake.
Okay, just the whole lake, you mean?
Oh, the whole
okay.
lake. The whole lake. And Sidoni,
mm-hmm.
who lives up the old channel, predicted that. And people began to have funny feelings.
Mm.
Called him a fortune teller and stuff like that. But he predicted many things
mm-hmm.
that came true.
Yeah.
Now, I gave each member of my family a copy of his book.
Oh, that's fabulous.
It's fascinating to read.
What's the name of that book?
Well, I'll have to go get it out of the...
What's it about? Just...
How he happened to come to White Lake.
Oh, that would be wonderful, Marie.
It is wonderful. And I decided on making this gift to the members of the family just so that they'll have something.
Mm-hmm.
There isn't anything anymore
mm-hmm.
that anybody is preserving. So I called Mary Sidoni, his Dr. Sidoni's
right. his daughter-in-law.
Daughter-in-law. So asked her if she had any copies. Oh, she said yes. She said they smell to heaven because they've been in the chapel
mm-hmm.
all these years. But she says, I've got 50 copies.
Oh.
Well, I bought one for every member of my family. We took care of a dozen. And then I began talking about it, and
mm-hmm.
people wanted to borrow mine. I said, you go buy your own. Cost you $5. So they did. A lot of people have borrowed it,
mm-hmm.
and I'm scared to death I'm never going to get it back.
Yeah, because I would imagine there are not any left now.
There are some left.
Are there?
There are some left.
Hmm.
And each library, Montague and Whitehall, have a copy of it.
Hmm.
Because I tried to instill the librarians to put in a shelf of books by White Lake authors.
Great idea.
Frank Adams would
sure.
be there.
Mm-hmm.
Sidoni would be there. There are other people
mm-hmm.
who write.
Oh yeah. And especially about things of the local area.
This
I
is
mean,
right.
Particularly Mr. Sidoni would have written about that, and that, you know.
Sure.
That would be wonderful to read.
Well, I think I'm going to close wishing all of you happy memories, as happy as the ones that we have lived through. It's been a gorgeous life. Thank you.
Thank you. In fact, I think the softball game that's this summer,
yeah.
Bonnie McCall and Doug Schaefer and Betsy Bennett are responsible for, I think they're lining it up to do a Lake Michigan White Lake team.
It would be absolutely
I'm
perfect.
Positive about that, but based on this long ago rivalry that, you know, you've talked about.
Well, it somehow that was inborn in people. You felt it the minute you came on the beach.
Now, were there the cottages, were they first being built on the Lake Michigan side or
yes.
the White Lake side?
No, on the Lake Michigan side.
So that was the preferable
yeah,
area.
And that's where people wanted to be.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't want to be on that White Lake side. We like it wild. And it was wild. They never cut the grass. They still don't cut the grass.
Mm-hmm.
They've got it as wild as they want it. That's their privilege.
Mm-hmm.
But the reason it's wild is because they have no sunshine.
Right, right.
You see, on the White Lake side,
we get all the east sun.
All the east sun.
Yeah.
And when we came, of course we went on the Lake Michigan side because the Middletons were there and they were our neighbors in St. Louis.
Sure.
And we simply went down the line.
Mm-hmm.
Now, somebody should tell you all about the twin cottages.
I've seen pictures of that, and that is now what presently
well,
Peggy
it's
Close
Nuveen.
And Nuveen's, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. And they were connected.
They were connected.
And what an unusual design for someone to have.
Well, you could walk.
Uh-huh.
And few people understand the architecture of these first cottages, because at the top of the stairs, because they were all two-story, except the little cottage,
mm-hmm.
and there was a large open area, and off of that area were all the bedrooms,
mm.
and by that time, a bathroom. But that was where the guests who rented rooms and came for a season would sit and have tea in the
mm-hmm.
afternoon, or sew and crochet, or even play a game of solitaire or cards.
Just sounds like just sort of get together and...
The people in who were renting rooms yeah. there.
Which is which we do today to a certain extent, not as genteel, but that's a favorite time for everybody to be sitting out on their porches. And
this is right. Mm-hmm. But we do not have, in this cottage, a big room at the top. Mm. Because it was built as a captain's home, and it was two rooms. Mm. And then everybody who's ever owned it has added on his own bit of architecture. Mm. And Mother named it properly, the place to come to. But people will pass by and say, oh, it's got to be Tokomoto. Some Indian name like that. Don't bother.
The place for people to come to? Uh-huh. Oh, I love it.
And it's called To Come To.
To Come To. Oh, that's great.
And every member of our family knows that in case of a world disaster, they make it back to the beach. 1 year, 10 years, 15 years, somebody will be there.
Right.
And during the war, I had my storeroom lined with canned food in case we were bombed.
Yeah.
And the kids, no matter where they were at the time, they drop that and they get to the beach. This was the meeting place.
That's a good plan.
And it still holds.
Mm-hmm. If there would be some disaster, that would be good to, because your family's all spread out. And
that's right.
Where would they know to even begin to start to collect? Well, that's good. Well, Harriett.
So you got yourself a job.
I got myself a store.
All right.
Way back then, we had no flashlights. So someone came up with the idea of a lamp chimney and having the local village smithy create a bottom for it and a place for a candle. They took this chimney, added the wire, so you've got a handle. But if the candle is high, your fingers are going to get blistered from the flame at the top. So they even put a place for your finger mm-hmm. so you could carry it like this. And this is how you walked down to the arcade or over to a friend's house after dusk at night. It was a candle lantern. And we saved one of ours. There are others that fold up together that have mica in them. Same principle exactly, but this is a treasure. At least it is to me.